probably got cats, ain't you? Huh? No? Well, this particular cat was sorry. It wouldn't hunt mice. And it stole eggs out of the chicken's nest. And all kind of stuff like that this fellow was trying to get rid of. Well, that's the story about this. It was yellow cat. Uncle John had troubles of his own. Had an old yellow cat that wouldn't leave home. Tried half a dozen times to give the cat away. The cat loved his master and he just wouldn't stay. The cat came back, the cat came back. Thought it was a goner, but the cat came back, cause he couldn't stay away. Now, a farmer said he'd get the cat and he would never fail. He loaded up his shotgun with dynamite and nail. Waited on the corner for the cat to come around. Half a dozen pieces of the man was all they found, but the cat came back. Thought it was a goner, but the cat came back, cause he couldn't stay away. In a balloon, said, would you give him to the man in the moon? That balloon burst open and everybody said, 90 miles away they picked the man up dead. But the cat came back, the cat came back. Thought he was a goner, but the cat came back, cause he couldn't stay away. To the one he loved best. Train went around the track and hit a broken rail. The cat was the only one left to tell the tale. The cat came back, the cat came back. Thought he was a goner, but the cat came back, cause he couldn't stay away. A brother said he'd get the cat and grabbed him by the tail. Slung him round and round and he throwed him down the well. We thought the cat was gone, but surely wasn't any doubt. But when we dropped the bucket up, the cat jumped out. The cat come back. Thought it was a goner, but the cat came back, cause he couldn't stay away. Near. Said, would you lose him in the jungle over there? When the ship returned, there arose a mighty cheer. The cat's feet were the very first to disappear. The cat came back, the cat came back. Thought he was a goner, but the cat came back, cause he couldn't stay away.
If they had room for any more at the shelter, and so she took them down to the shelter. She got down there and she thought, you know, these are such mangy, scroungy looking cats. Nobody's going to adopt them. So she got them rabies shots and made an appointment to have them neutered and took them home.
They make good banjo heads, you know.
No, I don't hear like that. My grandpa made them out.
I used to know some big tale about the, I probably can't get exactly right about that. That's all about a fiddle. How come they make the noise that they do? They're made out of, you know, they've got cat guts for strings. I mean, the old ones did, and originally that's what they had. And they've got a horse's tail for the They got all these animal parts, and sometimes you pull a horse's tail across a cat's gut, and the sand that comes out the assholes or something. Anyway, this Helen make a good sound come out of it this time with a old time tune called Leather Britches. Played that tune a lot with old Albert Hash, a fellow that lived right here in the park, right around the park here, and was raised near the park and lived here most of his life, right down just off the hill here, and somebody that I learned a lot of music from and traveled and played with a lot and worked with a little bit, and he's a great fiddle maker and a wonderful person, and just to me, the king of the park area here when it comes to old-time mountain musicians and everything. So here's one of Tim, it's sort of one of his blood teams.
And this fiddle is number one of two fiddles that Wayne has made.
Pennsylvania, and there was a young girl there had a little toy rabbit. It looked like a real one, but it reminded me of this thing that happened some long time ago. We're all, proud of our dogs and like to play with them, and they're like part of the family and everything. And I had this old dog that was just like a part of the family. And one morning I looked out in the yard, and old Fletcher was out there playing with something. I couldn't see what it was. It's something all covered up in mud and muddy, nasty mess or something. That's why I went out there. I better go see what he's got. I went out there and looked, and sure enough, he's all covered up with dirt and mud and everything. And it was my neighbor's little girl had a little white rabbit, and he had that rabbit. Oh, Lord, Fletcher, you have done it this time. You talk about trouble. We are in trouble. And here come the police right now, baby. They're telling about something. Anyway, I had a brainstorm where I looked over at the neighbor's house, and they were gone. They were not at home. And I took that little old rabbit, and I took it in the house and put it in the sink, and I washed that thing and shampooed it and blow-dried it. It looked just all fluffy and white and pretty, and I slipped it right back over across the fence over in its cage and put it right back in its cage. Right? And I thought, well, I think it's died. You know? That kind of thing, you know. So it seemed to work okay, and I looked out there the next morning, and there was a... quite a bit of commotion going on. There was all kinds of, you know, extra cars that I didn't know, and some other people down there, and some people had cameras, seemed like to be taking pictures and things, I think that's what they was fixing to do, and I just wondered what in the world is going on. And I walked over to the fence and sort of hollered at my neighbor and asked him, said, what in the world's going on here with all this commotion going on? He said, you wouldn't believe it. He said, you know, have you seen that, you know, that little rabbit that my daughter has? And I said, well, yeah, I've seen it around. He said, you know, yesterday, said that rabbit died, and we buried it out in the backyard. Today, that thing's right back in its cage, looks brand new, but it's still dead as a man. Trying to figure what's happening. Any of y'all that's got dogs, they don't ever dig up anything and bring it up in the yard or anything. So sometimes those tales like that, this stuff that happens, you know, and the good ones. Let me see. You got your guitar up?
Yeah.
Well, that sounds good. I'd like to hear a good song of some kind. Let's do, y'all do the Darlene Corey one. Has Herb ever done that?
No.
No.
Yeah, yeah.
I think I've heard it.
E chord. Know what happened. Put a paper on the third fret, your position markers are all staggered, you know.
And any of you singers will know that I flunked assertiveness. It develops the lower part of my voice. Thank you.
You can sing the song and say to one and all, you are my flower that's blooming in the mountain so high. You are my flower that's blooming there for me. Don't forget to smile. You are my flower that's blooming in the mountain so high. You are my flower that's blooming there for me. Sky just as blue as it was the day that I met you. You are my flower that's blooming in the mountain so high. You are my flower that's blooming there for me.
that's the word I'm trying to think of. And anyway, it's real fancy stuff. And she wanted to make it. Now, you know, years ago, a long time, you know, the style and the fancy thing. Y'all know what a bustle is? Everybody? Some of them ladies might, anyway, but it's a thing that makes the tail end of that dress stick way out there. And if you're pretty well to do, you could order things from Sears and Roebuck that looked almost like a bird cage that you put there and make the bustle stick way out and look real good and shaped right and everything. And but we couldn't afford things like that, and Mom was real resourceful. And she saved absolutely everything we had, every old feed sack, flour sack, everything like that. And we used that thing. I've had many a shirt made out of a feed bag, you know. But she had saved all that stuff, and Charlene wanted to order one of those bustles from Sears and Roebuck, and she, or bustle stuffers, or whatever they are. And we said there's no way we can afford that, but I've got some old, I've got an old flour sack right over there that you can stuff in that thing. It'll work just as good as that. And so that was all right. That's what she did, and she made her fancy dress, and you know, that nice chiffon material, and of course, you know, the deal is to go to church on Sunday, on Easter Sunday, and sort of wanted to show off her dress, and she had it fixed, and she come late, you know, like on purpose, so she could sashay all the way up the aisle and sit down on the front. You know, the Baptist churches fill up from the back, and there's never anybody on the front row. So that's what she did. She went sashaying right up the aisle and sat down on the front, and every time she got to notice, and every time she'd stand up to, you know, to sing like that, people start giggling and sniggering back behind her a little bit. And she got to worried about it a little bit. She looked down, is her petticoat showing, and have that thing, or what's wrong? Because it happened every time she stood up. And I thought she'd look around, and I couldn't see nothing. And after a while, when church let out, that's me and my brothers, you know, we got out there first, and on the way home, walking home, and she come behind us, and she said, what in the world was people laughing at when I stood up? And of course, we would not tell her. Thank the world, she just had a fit about that, and went tearing off to the house, and we had one of these old hall tree things, you know what they are, they'd hang hats on, had a mirror up way up in them, you could get up on them. She got in the house, first thing she done, she jumped right up on that thing, and turned around where she could see the back end of that thing, and sure enough, with that old flour sack in there and that clear, that sort of see-through material, getting great big letters right across the back end, that thing said 50 pounds at the road.
Thank you.
old hollow tree where you lay down a dollar or two. Go round the bend and come back again. There's a jug full of that good old Mountain Dew. They call it that good old Mountain Dew. And them bad refuse in a few. I'll hush up my mug if you fill up my jug with that good old Mountain Dew. Sawed off and short on, he measures about 4'2". But he thinks he's a giant when you give him a pile of that good old Mountain Dew. It comes in quarts, they call it that good old Mountain Dew. And them that refuse in a few. I'll brush up my mug if you fill up my jug with that good old Mountain Dew. June bought some brand new perfume and it had such a sweet smell of you. She had an analyzed it, much to her surprise, was nothing but good old Mountain Dew. They call it that good old Mountain Dew, and them that refuse it a few. I'll brush up my mug if you fill up my jug with that good old Mountain Dew.
Thank you.
Against his religion, but he carried his gun along. He shot himself 3 mighty fine quail, 1 little baby hare. On his way, returning home, he saw a great big grizzly bear. Now the bear marched out in the middle of the road, right up to the preacher, you see. The preacher got so excited that he climbed up a cinnamon tree. The bear sat down upon the ground, and the preacher climbed out on a limb. Then he cast his eye to the Lord in the sky, and his words he said to him, "Oh, Lordy, didn't you deliver Daniel from a lion's den? Also deliver Jonah from the belly of the whale and then 3 Hebrew children from the fiery furnace, so the good book do declare. Oh, Lord, if you can't help me, please don't you help that bear." He said, "Mr. Bear, if you bother me, I'll give you an awful fight." Just about that time, the limb let go and the preacher came tumbling down. You could see him getting his razor out before he hit the ground. Now he hit the ground, cutting right and left, put up a very good fight. Then the bear grabbed the preacher and he squeezed him a little too tight. Preacher dropped the razor and the bear held on with him. Then he cast his eye to the Lord in the sky, and his words he said to him, "Oh, Lordy, didn't you deliver Daniel from the lion's den? Also deliver Jonah from the belly of the whale, and then 3 Hebrew children from the fiery furnace, so the good book do declare. Oh, Lord, if you can't help me, please don't help that bear." Was a terrible fight. That bear just kept on hanging on, but the preacher was doing all right. He dragged that beast right down to the water, was 3 times in and out. Then the bear got up and he limped away, and the preacher began to shout, "Oh, Lordy, didn't you deliver Daniel from the lion's den? Also deliver Jonah from the belly of the whale, amen. And oh, Lord, it may not look like much from way up there, but the hardest job I've ever done was baptizing that bear."
About these bears, where I live is about 10 miles from here, and the folks that drive the big mail trucks down to Mount the Wilson from Roanoke park their trucks and sleep during the day across the road from them. Mount the Wilson is the end of the line, and then at 3 o'clock they go to the post office and they pick up mail all the way back to Roanoke. Well, the other morning one of them called me and said, "Helen, don't let your dog out this morning." I said, "Well, why not?" She says, "There's a bear up here." He said, I thought as I came up there were a couple of turkeys clustered awful close, but they started moving and it's a bear. So I told Wayne and he got pretty excited about it. Well, last night we got in really late and the dog had been in the house for a long time, so I said, "Grab the flashlight, Wayne. I've got to take Spencer out and let him have a walk." And Wayne was behind us, and we were, you know, walking down the ridge, and all of a sudden, one of the cows kind of charged towards us, and I thought Wayne was gone.
I wasn't thinking about no bear. I just couldn't get
It was a black cow.
It was just barely across the fence.
And it was breathing awful heavy.
A little bit of June apple. It's written by one guy, Hugh Moffitt, is that his name? He actually, after we did that, I guess that radio show must go everywhere, and Helen got an email from the fellow that wrote the song, and you know, appreciating us using it on a nationwide show like that. And after a while, he was real complimentary of our performance and everything, and which that was a real exciting thing to hear. And then I probably, he did call up later and said to ask her if she would like to know the proper lyrics to the anyways, good to hear from him. Real famous fellow. He's written songs for like number one hits for Alabama and Dolly Parton and people like that.
He told me Johnny Cash didn't get it right either.
Yeah, well, that's good. That's a good guy.
And I do now somewhere have the correct lyrics. I'm pretty pretty much over 25 now, and I have a promising career as a songwriter, and I like to write lyrics on the spot.
Well, here's a beautiful love song called The Rose of My Heart.
We're the best partners this world's ever seen. Together as close as can be. Somehow I never find time in between to tell you what you are to me. You are the rose of my heart. You are the love of my life. Flower not fading nor falling apart. If you're weak, let my love make you strong. Rose of my heart. You are the love of my life. Flower.